can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know.
Thank you. I try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. The many trials that seem to never end, His word declares this truth, that we will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that He brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to You always. I know the journey seems so long, you feel you're walking on your own, but there has never been a step, but you've walked down all alone. Troubled soul, don't lose your heart, 'cause joy and peace He brings, and the beauty that's in store outweighs the hurt of life's sting. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that He brings, that there will be a place where no more suffering. There will
night, as we visited, we shared several scriptures together that you wanted me to read from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. It says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have also have access by faith into His grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations as well, knowing that tribulation works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. and hope makes us not ashamed because of the love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. From Revelation 21, verse 4, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away." And from Proverbs 5, verses 5 and 6, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not into your own understanding. And in all thy ways acknowledge your God, and he shall direct your path." And then finally from Ecclesiastes 3, 1 and 2, and then verse 4, "To everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance." We'll hear a little bit more from Ecclesiastes 3, guys, in just a little bit. The family gave me some things to read and to share with you. And it begins this way. "Larry and Willa were two separate individuals that came together to live a life of love and integrity. They spent 54 years together as husband and wife. There were countless memories shared, and a legacy of caring and kindness continues within all who knew them. Larry was the fourth child in a family of 8 children. His father died when Larry was a boy, and his mother lived with her in-laws and raised the children. Larry was sensitive, according to his sister. He would help his sister Phyllis gather her geese when it rained, and was a helper to all when it came time to do chores. He trapped and hunted with his brothers, and the hunting continued for decades. He didn't participate in high school athletics. He joined FFA and began working at a local grocery store to help the family with finances while he was still in high school. Willa was the first and only daughter of James and Lennis Parker. She was born and raised in California, and she had various jobs growing up, but often told her children that her aversion to seafood started when she worked at a shrimp factory deveining shrimp. I think that would do it. She relocated to Smith Center, Kansas, where her parents were pastoring a church, and she began working at a local grocery store. Larry worked at Bogart for 25 years. He and two of his siblings worked in the same location when they were younger, and he met his wife, Willa, while working there. This young couple went to church on their first date. This same church, Calvary Gospel, was the site of their wedding on September 3rd, 1966. Larry was a steadfast husband to Willa. They lived in Smith Center at the start of their marriage, but soon moved to Ellsworth when Larry got a promotion. Willa shared that time there in Ellsworth provided the biggest shock of their married life. Larry went to work on March 31st as a father of 1 and came home that night as a father of 4. The couple didn't know Willa was carrying triplets. Willa was taken to the hospital by her parents since Larry was at work, and they called to tell him that his wife had safely delivered triplets. He thought it was an early April Fool's joke. The couple quickly adapted to caring for 4 children under 18 months old and later added another child into the mix. Once Larry started working for the railroad, he was gone overnight frequently. Willa held the family together. When Larry did have time off, the family traveled. Some frequent destinations were Eureka Springs, Nashville, St. Louis, Branson. Willa was instrumental in planning these trips. She researched the route to take, where to stay, activities to do, and sights to see. She also packed the picnic lunches and the snack bags. Larry and Willa continued traveling throughout their lives. They loved their time in Alaska, in which they traveled through and explored Canada along the way. They visited several national parks with their friend Kenny, and they enjoyed traveling to visit their family as well. They enjoyed seeing the countryside and still took weekly drives with friends in the last few months. Both were lifelong readers. Larry often took the children to the public library to get books. He loved Westerns, and Willa loved Christian romance novels. When they traveled, they brought the local paper and the Smith County Pioneer with them to stay caught up on the news. This couple taught their children to bake cakes and monster cookies, make homemade ice cream, to fish, ride bikes, plant a garden, clean a house, raise a pet, play board games, and most importantly, to treat people as you would want to be treated. The house was filled with love. Some of the best memories were sitting together at dinner. Will created a dinner chore chart so that the kids all knew what they needed to do before dinner to help and what they were expected to do to help with in cleaning up. Every meal began with a prayer of thanksgiving. The couple wanted to know about friends, school, sports, you name it, while the children talked about the table. Larry and Willa loved their grandchildren and cheering for them. When the oldest grandchildren were starting soccer, they paid them $1 for each goal they scored. Larry was still watching his grandchildren play the sports they loved as recently as this past month when he traveled to Wichita to see Taryn play soccer in the President's Cup. Both grandparents took pride in Juliana earning a cross-country scholarship and Mason playing for the K-State Wildcat football team. They cheered loudly with Winfield Viking t-shirts on when Trenton, Tanner, and Trey played soccer for Ark City's biggest rival. They were also their biggest prayer warriors as Trenton and Tanner served in the Marines. The grandparents attended numerous football, basketball, and soccer games. They were also excited. Jake and Cade made their high school soccer teams this season. Larry and Willa also attended volleyball and wrestling matches, cross country, and track and field track and field meets. One season, three granddaughters, Megan, Juliana, and Kylie, all ran for the same team. They enjoyed choir concerts and musicals. Tabor had the lead role in two musicals, which they were able to attend. Even in this season of quarantine, they watched live streams of Jack's piano recitals and choir concerts. They were also able to celebrate Jason's high school graduation this spring. Larry was also a supporter of all Ark City High School athletics. He and his friend Kenny could be seen cheering on the Bulldogs at football and basketball games. Larry and Willa were blessed with a great-granddaughter a year ago. They eagerly looked forward to the visits with Brooklyn. The joy she brought to them was immeasurable. Larry was set in his ways and could easily be teased due to his quirks. He collected coffee mugs and rotated them to be used equally. He did the same with his shirts. He started wearing baseball caps when he went to work on the railroad, and he has several that reflect his interests. Most recently, it was the K-State hat with his grandson's number on it. He had a green thumb and moved his house plants around the home to get the best light. He loved to garden. He was meticulous about keeping records. He didn't just fill his cars up with gas. He documented on how much the gas cost per gallon, how many gallons he bought, and what the current mileage was. Did he have better gas mileage this round or not? And you guys laugh about that, but that seems personally reasonable to me. Every receipt for an item purchased in the regards to the car was filed. He and Willa also shared in keeping track of the NFL games and scores. Before moving to the house on Birch, Larry's office was filled with pictures of his grandchildren, children, and babysitting kids. Their artwork and notes filled the room as well. These were his treasures. Another treasure became his train plates and train memorabilia, which would decorate the new home. He developed favorites in his life: Tom Brady, Shania Twain, Texas Roadhouse, putting together puzzles and cold, snowy days. He was a tough cookie. He loved much, and the only things he claimed to hate were ham, raisins, coconut, and maybe spinach and garlic. Willa was unique as well. She was a bowler and participated in weekly leagues for several years. Many families receive embroidered baby blankets courtesy of Willa's handiwork. She loved cooking at home, design magazines, and dreaming about RV lifestyle. Her favorite color was tie-dye. The brighter, the better. When going out on errands, she looked forward to seeing friends and everything. I was looking for that earlier and I couldn't find it. She loved making chicken and noodles for her family, and in turn, they loved eating them. She had a sweet tooth and often had a Coke and a bag of black licorice or black jelly beans close by. She lived for Hallmark movies and the Gaithers. One time, much to her son-in-law's dismay, the TV was changed to the Gaithers in the middle of a KU basketball game. Wow. I don't know how you took that, Mike. What's your dad's? Yeah. Another indulgence was scratch-off lottery tickets in a penny and a nickel slots. One Christmas, Larry decided to trick Willa. He put a patch of scratch-off tickets in all the stockings. Willa's was a winner, $10,000. She could not believe her luck. Unfortunately, her excitement was short-lived when she found out it was a prank. Mama was not happy for the rest of the day. I could see that. Larry and Willa had many friends. They listened to people and made them feel important. Several other children's friends have reached out to express the kindness their parents showed them at key points in their lives. They loved all the children Willa used to babysit and still lighted up seeing them around town. They influenced the lives of many through the in-home daycare. Larry's railroad buddies were another family to them. Larry loved spending time with the guys eating breakfast, going on drives around Ark City, and sharing stories while sitting on the patio. Larry was a man who looked you in the eye, shook your hand, noted your birthday, sent cards, and always wrote a thank you note. Willa loved Larry with all of her heart and how he treated others. She enjoyed his company and antics and expressed her loneliness this past week without him. Both were Christians and followed the Great Commission of wanting others to know about God and the need for a personal relationship with him. They raised their children in church. They listened to gospel music regularly, and they couldn't resist a good hymn sing-along. Larry taught Sunday school. Willa volunteered in the church nursery. They tithed faithfully and gave to missions. They trusted God to protect their family. They still were living a life honoring God until called home. One of Larry's last Facebook comments expressing knowing God was in control and his greatest wish was that all of his family would have a relationship with him. Larry and Willa will be missed. May they rest in peace and not be annoyed by each other snoring. This is from the pastor of their church, Pastor James Newman of the Assembly of God. Larry and Willa were so special to the First Assembly of God Church, as well to my family. They were always so faithful to church and always encouraging. Larry and Willa loved our fellowship get-togethers and especially church picnics out at Camp Horizon. They would always show up with plenty for everyone. They enjoyed just getting together with friends and church family and fellowshipping. I will never forget watching them come to church. Larry would pull up under the awning to let Willa out, and then as he would walk up the drive, he would greet me with a smile and a handshake or a hug and ask me if he had beat the Shires for the first pew. They had an ongoing race every Sunday before COVID onto who would get to church first. I will definitely miss and have missed them sitting on the north side of the sanctuary with Kenny Mann worshiping Jesus. Our conversations about family and how everyone was doing and who I could be praying for. They always filled me in on how everyone was doing. They were so proud of all of their children and grandchildren. And yet a conversation never went by where they didn't ask me how Shonda or Esme were doing. I so appreciated their love and concern for my family as well. Tammy and Tom, Teresa and Scott, Tanya and Brooks, Tim and Michelle, Trina and Mike. You have an amazing, rich heritage that has been passed on to you and your children by your parents, your in-laws. May that continue to be passed from one generation to the next. Larry and Willa loved Jesus, and they are a big part of why Kenny Mann is in church today as well. They loved Jesus, and they loved all of you so much, and their desire was that you kept following their example. I just can't even fathom what a sight they are seeing today with Jesus. They have lived their life of faith, for they are now experiencing. They have joined that cloud of witnesses that Hebrews 12 talks about, and now they are cheering us on to run the race and to keep the faith. Larry and Willa have fought the good fight. They have finished the race. They have kept the faith. And they have received that crown of righteousness. We love you all. We are praying for you and the comfort of the Holy Spirit to be with each and every one of you. God bless. And now, Tammy, Do you want to come up?
Well, I wanted to say a few words as well, not just because I'm the oldest, but because I'm the most favorite daughter. And we never really got a chance to say goodbye to our parents. Our parents meant the world to us. I've said it several times since Dad passed away. He was our rock. He worked hard to provide for us, and we never went without. He never missed a birthday, even if the only thing you got was a king-sized Hershey bar. Sorry, triplets. And man, did he love to write those thank you cards, which you've already mentioned. We'd love to get them. We could barely read them, but gosh, that's what we looked forward to. He was quiet, patient, kind-hearted. He loved his family, and he loved God deeply. Mom was the polar opposite of Dad. She was outspoken. She was never afraid to offer her opinion, and she never met a stranger. She held her family together while Dad was on the road, no small feat with five kids. Mom was more reserved with her feelings, but we knew we were loved. I can't begin to count the number of children that she babysat and became a pseudo-mom to. Just like Dad, she loved her family and God more than anything. Our parents were good, caring, and loving people. They changed the lives of many people, and their legacy will live on in all of us. I said to my daughter as we were driving to Kansas, "Well, Dad only got 1 week of peace and quiet before Mom got up there." She said, "Nope. Papa went first to make sure heaven was suitable for her. Then when he wanted her to join him, she came." It's wonderful to believe that. They needed each other. We will miss them more than we can imagine, and our hearts will never heal from our loss. But we are the lucky ones because they were our parents. Rest in peace until we meet again. We love you.
Before I read what Tim has brought me, is there anybody else that wanted to say anything? Okay. This is entitled, "What is a Parent and a Grandparent?" A parent and a grandparent is someone who wants to catch you before you fall, but instead picks you up and brushes you off and lets you try again. A parent and a grandparent is someone who wants to keep you from making mistakes, but instead lets you find your own way, even though their hearts break in silence when you get hurt. A parent and a grandparent is someone who holds you when you cry, scolds you when you break the rules, shines with pride when you succeed, and has the faith in you even when you fail. This is who my parents were. Thank you, Tim. Family has put together some pictures for a video and some songs. I'm gonna let you guys watch this with all the music now.
Did you quit or did you try? Live your dreams hardest if wind blows the hardest? Will you bend or will you break?
Back diamond rings. I wish every porch had a swing. Wish kids still learned to say sir and ma'am, how to shake a hand. I wish every state had a Birmingham. I wish everybody knew all the words to mama tried. I wish Monday mornings felt just like Friday nights. And I wish even cars had truck beds, and every road was named Copperhead, and coolers never run out of cold Bud Light. And I wish high school home teams never lost, and back road drinking kids never got caught. And I wish the price of gas was low, cotton was high. I wish honky tonks didn't have no closing time. And I wish grandpas never died. I wish Sundays on the creek bank would never end. Wish I could learn to drive again. Wish the first time 17 she was my everything kiss in a Chevrolet could happen every day. I wish everybody overseas was gonna make it home. I wish country music still got played on country radio. And I wish even cars had truck beds, and every road didn't have farms never got sold. And I wish even cars had truck beds, and every road was named Copperhead, and coolers never run out of cold Bud Light. I wish high school home teams never lost, and back road drinking kids never got caught. And I wish the price of gas was low and cotton was high. And I wish honky tonks didn't have no clothes and tie. And I wish grandpas never died. I wish grandpas never died.
Outside, it's like God let me dial up the weather. Got the whole crew here, I ain't seen some of them in forever. It's one of those never forget it, better stop and take it in kind of scenes. Everything's just right, yeah, except for one thing. You should be here, standing. Cutting up, cracking a cold beer, saying cheers. Hey y'all, it's sure been a good year. It's one of those moments that's got your name written all over it. And you know that if I had just one wish, it'd be that you didn't have to miss this. You should be taking way too many pictures on your phone, showing them off to everybody that you know back home, and even some you don't. Yeah, they say now you're in a better place, and I would be too if I could see your face. You should be here, standing with your arm around me here, cutting up, cracking a cold beer, saying cheers. Hey y'all, it's sure been a good year. It's one of those moments, it's got your name written all over it. And you know that if I had just one wish, it'd be that you didn't have to miss this. Oh, you should be here, you'd be loving this, you'd be freaking out, you'd be smiling. Yeah, I know you'd be all about what's going on.
Visiting with members of the family last night, we talked about a lot of things. That how many people in the community have told the kids how proud their parents were of them. how much their family just loved. Loved their family, loved their friends, loved the kids they took care of, loved God. The impression that they made on the people in the community. All the kids that they took care of. Talking about relationships. Things that their dad taught them about. Never thinking that people were neither above you or below you. To always treat people as you'd want to be treated. That growing up, the kids didn't know that their parents didn't have a lot. But always had what they needed. They spoke of family vacations and time with just family. They talked about the lights on the side of the house, that their dad had planned for those, but he never really got quite to see them. We could talk about sad things all day long, but I told you I would share with you a little bit more from Ecclesiastes. And Jim, these kids are all too young. They didn't grow up in the 60s like we did. They never heard the birds sing, turn, turn, turn. But when you had those scriptures from Ecclesiastes, a time to be born and a time to die. And many of you could think about all the ones that are in that piece of scripture. And that's where people stop, because that's kind of where the song stops. But I would have you listen to the next few lines from Ecclesiastes 3. It begins with verse 9. It says, "What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the burden that God has laid upon men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity into the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing for men and women than to be happy, to do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all of their toil. This is a gift from God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it. Nothing can be taken from it. God does it so his children will revere him." And in all the things that I have heard and knew about Larry and Willa, I think they lived out those last few verses that I read very well, to the very best of their ability. They loved, they worked hard, they enjoyed their lives. They enjoyed raising five kids and getting five sets of in-laws that they just included into their family and made feel welcome. And all of the children that they had, or the grandchildren that they had, and I'm sorry all of you lost out when Brooklyn was born, that you were all replaced with her. And I say that in jest, and you know it. I can't imagine two people who loved each other more or fuller, who also loved God so much and spent so much time influencing the children that they raised as their own and the children of the community that they helped raise to be something better, to be something stronger, to be something more passionate, to be something more loving, something more worshipful, so that they could know the love of God that they knew, so that they could know the pride that they knew in you, so they could teach and share and teach you how to teach and share. I think you guys have been so blessed, and I think you know it. And we look at what is in front of us, two caskets. But look deeper than that and beyond it. Look at two lives that created so much and loved so much and has left a beautiful legacy in each and every one of you. I shared with the kids last night that if we remember someone and we love them and we honor their lives and we do more than that, that we teach our children and our grandchildren and we share the stories of a great love, then something wonderful happens. Larry and Willa don't die. They live in the hearts and minds of those who love them and remember them still. If you share stories with grandchildren and great-grandchildren and the generations to come, the stories of these two, not only of their great love and their great patience, but even their sense of humor, even the way they loved to have a good time, even when they got angry, even when they snored so much they kept each other awake, then they continue to live. The song said, how will we be remembered? Will we be remembered? It's not will, it's how. How will these two be remembered by you and so many in the community? I think it is with great admiration, with great thanksgiving, with great joy. We may have great sorrow because of the way that they were stricken from us. But at the same time, we can rejoice that they are with God. We can rejoice that we have so many wonderful memories. When I saw her last Thursday, or the Thursday before, on the 19th, I went by the house, and she was handing me the drawing for the marker. She asked me, and I teased her over the phone. She says, how are we going to do this? I have COVID. You don't. You don't want it. And I said, well, just do it like a hostage exchange. You lay it on the porch, and I'll come up and get it. And she laughed, and okay. And she got out there, and she put that out there and just kind of had a little fun with it. And she told me about Larry not feeling good. And I said, if you need help, let me know. She said, well, we have plenty. And he's going to be fine. And that was the last day that I talked to either of them. You know, for being 74 and 81, they had so much energy, so much feistiness, so much love for one another. I think that is something for us to look forward to keep relationships with our spouses alive and interesting. And that's what life is about, isn't it? It is about relationships. We are born into this world, and the first relationship that we have is with our mother and father. If we're lucky, we have some brothers and sisters. And then when we get older, we have friends in school, and we have a relationship with them. And then sometime later on, someone special comes along. And then if we're lucky, we have children of our own. And the cycle repeats and repeats. And each one of those is about a relationship. How close we choose to be. How involved. How much time we spend. How much of our heart is given. If we have done those things, then when someone passes, our heart breaks. But because of a relationship with Jesus Christ like these two had, and like they have instilled in you, that even though that earthly relationship ends, that emotional, that spiritual relationship never, ever ends. That is the legacy that they would want you to remember above anything else they ever gave you. Any other time that they spent with you, they would want you to know the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ that they knew. And for those friends who are listening today, that is what Larry and Willa would want for you. That same peace, that same comfort, that same joy that is in Christ Jesus. If you but choose to follow him, you have honored them in the greatest of ways. Today we have sad duty. And as I spoke with the children last night, there are even sadder days to come. But there is also comfort and peace and laughter and tears and rejoicing and the knowledge that mom and dad are with God, where they have always desired to be. Let us go to our God in prayer. Lord God, we have felt your presence here with us today as we have laughed, as we cried, and we have listened to beautiful music, and will continue to do so. That we have read in your scriptures and that we believe. That in our hearts and in our minds we have no doubt that these two beautiful people are with you. We ask that you comfort this family, that you encourage these friends to be in contact with them, to share with them Larry and Willa stories. So that they know even more of the impact their parents have made. Share with these young people, God, your comfort. With these grandchildren, your strength and courage. And let them know that you are here and present in our lives. We ask for your guidance, your comfort, and your peace. Amen.